Hey, honey.
Yeah?
Yeah, just so you know, I'm recording this. I just got a cease and desist letter from Little River Band.
What?
Yeah, Wayne Nelson and Steve Housden's attorney.
Why in the world? That's just crazy.
I like to talk about music and memories. And I do it by creating many documentary-style videos for social media. And I also work it into my commentary when I'm on Sirius XM. Well, I had decided to do a piece on Little River Band because I just have these lifelong memories associated with their music. So when I hear a song like Lady...
let me take a look at you now.
Lonesome Loser... the Night Owls, it's like, bam, I immediately go back in time. Well, it would be through the process of creating that initial post that I realized that while the music of Little River Band is really strongly associated with, attached to many of my memories, I actually didn't know anything about the names or the faces of the band members. And little did I know that at that time, I was about to go down a rabbit hole.
You were too soon. No, only in relation to the run, but you see, the thing is that there wasn't enough warning for it.
Oh, crap, I'm not recording. Hold on, let me get audio started. All right, so where do you think I should start?
Well, why don't you just start from the beginning and just, like, why is this a story worth telling?
Okay, so you want me to talk about how we ended up in the current state we're in now?
Yeah.
In other words, how did a band that was once the pride of Australia now have a complete performing lineup of nothing but Americans?
Something like that.
Well, the story's even crazier than that if you think about it, because what you really have is the original members, the ones who wrote and still have the rights to the hit music. They've been wanting and willing to play in America over the last two decades. The problem is that nobody really knows who they are by their face or by their name, or at least there's not a strong enough recognition for them to receive support from concert promoters. Well, on the same time, you've got the band that's actually touring as the Little River Band is not made up of anybody who owns any of the rights to the hit songs that they perform. And from what I've been able to tell, yeah, they probably don't want to play in Australia because I don't think they'd be welcomed there with open arms. The story's pretty well known and understood in Australia.
Starting in February 75, by August 76, we had a breaking record in America. And I really think if that hadn't happened, we wouldn't have been there a year later, because it was really the American success that really made us say, well, look, we need to try hard to stay in the same room here, because there's a lot for all of us here.
And how do you feel about leaving for London, Mr. Briggs?
Very, very tense, Mr. Lolly, very tense.
LRB's reputation is in the past, and thank God it is.
Yeah.
But there's still ways to go.
So when I started trying to learn the story about the Little River Band, more specifically the story about the three primary songwriters and the original vocalists, Glenn Schork, Graham Goble, Bee Birtles, I found it to be fairly confusing, almost as if there's been an effort to literally blur the lines between information that's relevant about the current iteration of Little River Band versus information that's really more relevant towards the original and classic lineup members. And a couple examples of what I'm talking about. If you go to the current Little River Band's website, you'll see that they're very eager to bring attention to the hit songs that are historically associated with the band name Little River Band. But nowhere on the page do they ever mention the names of the guys who originally wrote and recorded those songs, the guys who to this day still own the rights to the music. Additionally, I would listen to a number of interviews from current members of Little River Band, and rarely, if ever, do they ever mention the original members by name, instead always referring to them as that guy, those guys, the old guy, the elderly, them.
Well, yeah, one of our older members, elderly members, that's me, obviously not in the band anymore. And
inevitable band disagreements started to take their toll, and people started to drop away, and the last one left about 20 plus years ago.
And I'm serious. One of them left in 1983.
So as I've shared this story with people, you know, I've found that a lot of folks know the music. They love the music of Little River Band, but oftentimes they don't associate the song with the band. Common responses are, oh, I love the song. I didn't know that was Little River Band, or I thought that was a one-hit wonder, or I just thought that was somebody else's music. And those folks who do associate this song with the band, this is where it starts to become more like a Mandela effect, where some people will say, yeah, I remember that being an Australian band, or other folks say, oh, I thought that was an American band. And there's this confusion there. So, you know, what's the real story? Well, I would come to learn that the real story here is really a massive failing in the U.S. copyright law, where a lot of the rights go to the owner of the band name at the cost of the rights of the people that own the music. Because there's really not a whole lot that a songwriter can do to stop somebody from performing their music live. There's some things. For example, in 2015, Glenn Shorrock was able to block the Little River Band from performing on the Jimmy Fallon show by not granting a sync license. But when it comes to playing live, yeah, there's really nothing that they can do to stop Little River Band from performing their music live, which means for 25 plus years, Stephen Housden, who owns the name to Little River Band, has been able to outfit and operate and manage a band across America, performing songs, many of which he doesn't own the rights to. Meanwhile, the folks who do own the songs, who wrote, originally recorded, and continue to own the songs to this day, there's been a want to perform in America, but they've been greatly blocked on how they can associate with the band name. And unfortunately, many Americans don't know the name Birtles, Shorrock, and Goebel. Hurry, don't be late. I can hardly wait. I said to myself, wait. As I would come to learn more about the story of the Little River Band, the story of the founders, it would really occur to me that this is probably the most complex behind the music type story that I've ever ran across. I mean, it's far more than just a dispute over a trademark. I mean, I would come to learn that not all the original members knowingly and by their choice and execution would give up their rights to the trademark. But even beyond that, the real story to me is that it's the story of over the last 20 years, we've had an apathetic market that really has taken no interest in getting their facts straight about the Little River Band. I mean, we see this in almost all the interviews that I've listened to with, say, Wayne Nelson, that even if the interviewers just did 5 minutes of research before the interview, they would realize that the person they're about to talk to had nothing to do with some of the hit songs, wasn't even in the band at the time the songs were being recorded.
You being in the moment when that seed was first planted for even a song like Cool Change, I mean, you were there when it was happening. What goes through you when something like that happens? And then you start adding harmony to it. You had to be in a place of awe.
I want to clarify that I joined the band in 79. So there was a stable of hits that had already been created. But to join into that and then start working on things like Night Owls and yep. Take It Easy on Me, and so on.
I remember Cool Change started as a reggae song.
You know, I was feeling, hey, you know, I'm just with these guys all the time. If there's one thing in my life that's missing, it's the time that I spend alone. Bing.
I think a lot of Glenn's songs started as a reggae feel because he loved reggae music. I hated reggae music.
If there's one thing in my life that's missing, sailing on the cool and bright clear water. There's lots of those friendly people showing me ways to go, and I never want to lose their inspiration. Change.
I love the song, as I did Reminiscing To. I love Reminiscing To.
We spent a lot of time, almost as much time as we spent on Reminiscing, trying to get the right approach to it.
From memory, I think that when we sang the outgoing choruses of Cool Change, we were all around one mic, and it was just incredible as it was going down to tape. And that's probably my favorite part of the song.
Well, I guess Little River Band has ended up a continuation of my very first band when I was like 16. And the way it sort of worked, I'd keep one guy or two guys from the band and then form the next band, and that would go for a couple of years, and then keep another couple of guys and go on. And eventually that happened with Mississippi. There was a band in Adelaide called Travis Wellington Hedge. It's one of those times where you had weird names. And that eventually became Alison Gross, and then eventually became Mississippi. We ended up doing the Mississippi album as a three-piece band with a lead singer, a guitarist, and myself. So when the Mississippi album was recorded, it was very successful. We won Album of the Year and Single of the Year in 1972, but we had no live band. So we moved to Melbourne, and then we looked around for musicians to play live. And that was when I met Beeb.
One day the phone rang and I picked up the phone, and this voice goes, oh, excuse me, I'm trying to get in touch with Beeb Birtles. And I said, well, you're talking to him, you know. He said, and the voice said, well, I'm Graham Goble. I've come over with this band from Adelaide, and we've just recorded an album called Mississippi. And would you be interested in, you know, coming down? And, of course, Graham knew of me as a bass player, having played in Zoot. So he said, we're looking for a bass player. Are you interested in coming to, you know, hear the album we've just recorded? They played me the whole Mississippi album, which just blew me out of my seat. And I was listening to it, and all I could think was, I've got to be part of this. Make way for the key. I ended up joining Mississippi, and we worked together, Graham and I, and Derek Pellicci.
Beeb came to join us, and Derek on drums, and we had a few different bass players by the time we went to England.
So at this point, the lineup is almost complete, but it was suggested that they should find a lead singer.
You know, who do we know who as a lead singer? And I think it was maybe me who said, well, the best guy I can think of is Glenn Charick.
Having tried to break the English market with Twilights and then with Axiom, both of which failed, I found myself in London for about 5 years, and I did whatever I could to earn a living, and that included starting serious songwriting.
Glenn came over to the place where Graham and I were living, and we sat around and we actually sang some harmonies before, you know, the guys went back to Australia. And from that moment, from the moment that we heard our voices together, we knew that we had something special.
Lately, I've been thinking about settling down. Find me a life of my own.
Basically, what we did is we played him some of our songs to see whether he would be at all interested in doing something with us.
Oh, so I auditioned you.
Looks yeah, like
it. That's right. So now with the core lineup in place, as the story goes, while they were traveling to a gig, an unintended observation actually would result in the band changing their name.
I remember it was one of our very, very first engagements in a place called Geelong. And as you drive down to Geelong, you pass a little place called Little River on the way. Glenn saw the sign and said, oh, that would be a good song title. And like immediately following that, he said, Little River Band.
Passing the sign says Little River Exit 1 mile, and it goes into legendary terms now. And the gag is another half mile down the road, we would have been called Wrong Way Go Back, or the Geelong Band, or Men at Work. Think about that.
And it would be that lineup of George McArdle, David Briggs, Derek Pellici, Graham Gobel, Bee Birtles, and Glenn Shark that would end up producing 6 top 20 hits, 3 hitting the top 10, all in the latter part of the 1970s. So this is probably where you're starting to wonder how a band that starts off as an Australian supergroup tied to other Australian bands such as Zoot, which would include Rick Springfield, Axiom, obviously Mississippi. You know, how does it become a band made up of a performing lineup predominantly of American session musicians playing exclusively in America, performing a set list, the majority of which they don't own the rights to? Well, this is where it becomes an incredibly complicated story to tell. And unfortunately, it looks like it involves the band's manager, Glenn Wheatley, who would play an incredibly important role in helping to establish the band's early success.
I mean, he did go to America with no funds and his American Express card, and he just put everything on the card and had to come back with a deal, which he did.
Christmas Eve, 75, I got the phone call from Capitol Records. From Rupert Perry, in fact, who was running the company at that time, and said, Glenn, we love it. We'd like to do a deal with you.
Glenn Wheatley really did play an important role in helping Little River Band achieve early success, which is why it made it even more shocking when it would start to be realized that he had executed a series of business transactions that would directly impact the future ownership of the band. Now, in connecting with some of the original members, the general sentiment is that he didn't do this with malice, but more so without just understanding what the future consequence could be. One of the statements that I heard repeatedly was, you know, there were just things that we didn't think about at that time. And to explain what happened with Little River Band, I'll try to make it as simple as possible, but you got to think about it at the top level, underneath the umbrella of Little River Band, there'd be 3 companies set up. And each company was set up at a different time for a different purpose. And to keep it simple, let's just call them Company A, Company B, and Company C. With Company A established in 1975 at the onset of the band, the shareholders would be would consist of the original or the classic lineup, as well as Glenn Wheatley. In 1979, Company B would be set up in correlation with the Capitol Records recording contract. And the shareholders would consist of a smaller subset of Company A. And then in Company 1987, Company C would be set up. And Company C would have 3 original members, Glenn Shork, Graham Gobel, and Derek Pellici, as well as 2 new members, Wayne Nelson and Stephen Housden, who had actually joined the band in 1980 and 1981. As session musicians, but they would become full members in 1987. And it's important to also point out that the U.S. trademark for the name Little River Band would be assigned to Company A, while the Australian trademark would be assigned to Company B. And there was a mistake here because the U.S. trademark was supposed to be assigned to Company B, but a clerical error ended up assigning it to Company A. Now, in 1987, with the MCA recording contract, MCA required control of the brand, which is where things start to get, I don't know, kind of odd. Because in 1987, Company B would lose the rights to the Australian trademark because the renewal fee wasn't paid. And at the time it happened, none of the shareholders in Company B were informed that they had lost that trademark. Well, about 6 months later, Glenn Wheatley would initiate the process of transferring the U.S. trademark from Company A to Company C without telling anybody. And about 5 or 6 months after that, he would actually totally deactivate or deregister Company A entirely. And at the time, the shareholders had no idea that, one, they had lost the U.S. trademark, and two, that the company was no longer active. Now, in 1991, the Australian trademark would be assigned to Company C rather than reassigning it to Company B. And at this point in time, Company C is the owner of both trademarks, and the shareholders, Glenn Shork, Derek Pellici, Graham Gobel, Wayne Nelson, and Stephen Housden, are now owners of the incredibly valuable Little River Band trademarks, and they're completely unaware of it. So in 1992, when Graham Gobel left, and in 1996, when Wayne Nelson left, both would return their shares to the company, and in doing so, they would unknowingly give up their rights to the band name. Well, in 1997, the three remaining owners, Glenn Shorrock, Derek Pellici, and Stephen Housden, would be made aware that the trademarks were assigned to that company. Glenn Shorrock would be given the opportunity to buy out the other two members, but ultimately Derek Pellici and Stephen Housden would leverage their two-thirds ownership to do a forced buyout of Glenn Shorrock. And later on in 1997, Derek Pellici would sell his 50% share to Stephen Housden, making him the legitimate and exclusive owner of the Little River Band name. So after receiving the cease and desist letter, well, you know this, we talked about it.
Yeah.
And we decided that, you know, probably the first thing to do would be to address the concerns in the letter openly. So I posted my response online. The purpose of this post is to actually speak directly to Stephen Housden, owner of the Little River Band trademark, and Wayne Nelson, frontman and leader of the current performing iteration of the Little River Band. I had reached out to you directly with the invitation to speak to you because I realized there was a deeper, darker story behind the music that I was going to have to address. I looked for ways to avoid it, but the reality is, as I started doing early posts, I would get comments like, the original members lost their voice when they knowingly sold their rights to the music. And what I would come to learn is not all the members knowingly of their choice and execution gave up their rights to the name of the band. But there was an element to the story that had to be told, and you chose not to respond to me. And so I moved forward the best I could with the information I had been able to gather, and the information came very close directly from the source of events and that had been double-checked and then, you know, even triple-checked through different sources outside of that. So I moved forward with the knowledge that I'd been able to attain up until this point without your input. I acknowledged your legitimate right as owner, exclusive owner, of the Little River Band name, and even went as far as to make sure that I was very clear to acknowledge your longstanding, yours and Mr. Nelson's longstanding relationship with the Little River Band name and your relationship with the original founders of the Little River Band and how they brought Mr. Nelson and yourself on board as session musicians in 1980 and 1981, how they brought you on as owners and directors in 1987, and even explaining how, Mr. Housden, you became the legitimate and exclusive owner of the Little River Band trademark. Which brings me to your cease and desist letter, because in it you talk about protecting your rights. And I understand that, but what I'm curious about is how you protect and respect the rights of others. Because you see, the best I can tell is you bought the rights to the band name. And when you did that, you did not get the rights to any of the songs. The rights to the hit songs are still with the men who wrote and originally recorded those songs. Bee Birtles, Glenn Shorrock, Graham Goble, David Briggs. You do not own the rights to those songs, but yet you continually perform them. And I'm left believing that if given the opportunity, the songwriters, the ones who own those rights, would not grant you the ability to perform those songs. At best also, I can tell in doing the research, it doesn't seem like your band is submitting the set lists to the PRO so that the performance royalty fees being paid by the venues are being properly allocated back to the songwriters. Your cease and desist letter also talks about protecting your business venture in the U.S. And my question to you is the business venture that you want to protect, the business model that's based on leveraging the sense of nostalgia and the emotions in people like me who have memories attached to the music, you want to leverage that in order to sell tickets to bring people to your concert for your band to perform songs that they don't own the rights to. And I find it interesting that in 2016, 1 year after your band was blocked from performing on the Jimmy Fallon show, you released an album called The Hits Revisited, where 9 of the 11 songs on that album, you don't even own the rights to. And I found it interesting that in 2004, the Little River Band was honored by the Australian Recording Industry Association. But the reality is that was not the band under your ownership tenure that they were celebrating. It was the original, the classic lineup. But to your credit, you did release License long enough for one night for the classic lineup to come together to perform as the Little River Band. And it sounded like they kicked ass.
Hang on, help is on its way. I'll be there as fast as I can.
It seems like where convenient, you'll attach the name Little River Band to elements of its legacy, such as the hit songs and the accolades. But nowhere on the page do you reference the names of the people that actually wrote and originally recorded the songs, making them hits, which essentially is the foundation for your entire business model. You know, a lineup of musicians who in their heyday put up as many hit songs as the Eagles and Fleetwood Mac, and sadly, whose story is very deserving of being told in a place like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but I don't ever see it happening now because it is just, the current state is just too confusing. It's a mess. So tragically, I don't ever see that happening because the reality is the story is no longer about the band. You bought the band name, but you didn't buy the rights to the music. And for me, the story is about the music and the memories and the artists who wrote and recorded that music. That would be Bee Birtles, Glenn Shork, Graham Goble, the founders, the original voices of the Little River Band. So where do we go from here? Well, that depends on what's important to you. As a fan and as a listener, if what's important is building that connection with the original songwriters and the artists who originally recorded the music that's attached to your memories, then in the case of the Little River Band, you need to start building an awareness of the names and the faces of the ones who wrote all the hit songs. Graham Goble, Bee Birtles, Glenn Shork, David Briggs. In addition, I've written a letter that I've already sent to my congressman, but you can download it and send it to your congressman if you want to inform them that it's important to you that we create better protections for songwriters and consumers. When a band evolves to the point where there is no longer anybody affiliated with the band that holds any of the rights to the hit songs that are traditionally affiliated with that band, maybe in the case of the Little River Band, maybe it should be called Stephen Housden's Little River Band to help inform people that don't know that the lineup that they're about to go see are essentially just playing covers of the hits. And if you want to respect the original founders, well, last year they released two new compilation albums, Ultimate Hits and Masterpieces. And if you want to pay tribute to them, then download, stream, or purchase these albums because these are the original voices of the Little River Band, Bee Birtles, Glenn Shork, and Graham Goble.